Yeah, guys, so now we are finally on to the last segment of the section, which is feature engineering, right? So I have probably been talking about feature engineering in the starting of the lecture a bit, where I mentioned that feature engineering is something which is extremely important to currently most of the data science problems that we have around the world. And you'll go around, look at it in Kaggle, any place you go, you would tend to see that feature engineering is the most critical technique that a good lot of Kaggle competition winners have been using it for over the last good 2-3 years, right? So what is it about that feature engineering which makes it so unique and gives such a good competitive strength to all of the winners, right? So there's nothing. It's a very simple engineering hack. There's nothing that is rocket science about what we are going to talk right now. It's something which is very simple, very intuitive, something very easy for you to understand, right? And in fact, while we talk about it, you would be probably be getting a hang of it. This has got more to do with your domain expertise and more understanding of the data than to probably a textbook curriculum which just tells you, okay, you do this. As of now, we have talked about pre-processing, where we talked about scaling, standardization. We talked about how to impute missing values, outlier values. Please remember, most of them were basically some guidances, some pointers as to what all things you can do. Does not mean necessarily you have to follow only those techniques to replace your missing values or replace your impute your outlier values, right? Similarly, there are some techniques that we are going to talk about here which is used generally for feature engineering. But just because we are talking about this does not restrict you to kind of explore only this kind of things for feature engineering. There's a huge world out there. Please go out, have a look, try and work on real life data sets to understand what exactly is feature engineering. But let's first kind of get a hang of what feature engineering is and that's what we are going to do right now here. So John was going through the entire data and he thought that there are three features which kind of make a lot of intuitive sense. Like, ideally they should not be three different features, they should be somehow be combined into one particular feature, right? So what are those three features? The first one is basement bath, the second is full bath, and the third is half bath, right? So these are all features which are related with your washroom area, right? So why is that there are three different features for them? Ideally they should be combined into something which is one particular area, right? That's what you want. So that's exactly what is, I would say, is a more intuitive idea about feature engineering. So this is one of the most widely used concept of feature engineering, which is basically combining multiple features. We are going to talk about this in a while. So what is feature engineering? Feature engineering is nothing but using your domain expertise along with your engineering creativity and combining all of that to come up with features that are not originally present in your data set, but those features which are more representative of the data set and probably would help you crack the problem much easier and much faster than the rest of the guys who are just using the features as it is. So feature engineering is using your expertise or creativity or whatever it is to come up with new features that you think are more representative of the target variable than the original features, right? And it is obviously, it is something that is probably, it's difficult, it's time consuming, and it requires knowledge, right? Like every good thing that you've probably ever come up with, it also requires difficult and time consuming, right? So that's obviously a given. And this is something I would obviously say that it's probably the most important thing that you would probably do in your data science career. You go wherever you want to, you kind of do whatever problem you work on. Feature engineering is gonna be a good critical part of it. As long as you're doing machine learning based techniques, you're gonna handcraft your features, you're gonna use features that are there in the data set. Feature engineering is gonna be something which is extremely critical, and that's something that is evidenced by the fact that, you know, so many people across an industry, in Kaggle challenges, everyone has been using feature engineering to a good extent and getting very good results out of that. So the art of coming up with new features with more predictive power, as I was saying, which are more representative of the data than your original features. That is the whole game of feature engineering, right? So you have your given features, you are given some 10-15 features of which you somehow combine them, tweak them, break them, make them, do whatever you want to do with them. But somehow you come up with, using those 10 features, you come up with 5 more features. And using those 5 features, you probably come up with a much better model than you can come up with using the original 10 features. So that is the whole concept of feature engineering. Break your features, tweak them, mold with them, just do whatever you want to, but come up with something that is more representative. And we are going to get an idea of all of that in a while. Let's just go through the slides for now. So there are, I would say these are some basic pointer techniques. I've already told you, this doesn't mean that this is the entire universe of all possible feature engineering techniques. The first is applying domain expertise. The second is combining feature and then encoding of categorical variables and time series feature extraction and NLP feature extraction. Now today for this particular session, we are only going to cover applying domain expertise, combining feature and encoding of categorical variables. As and when we do time series and NLP in the later sessions of the lecture series, then that's when you would probably get a much more better idea of how the last two techniques work. But for now, let's focus on the first three, right? And out of which the first one is, which says applying domain expertise, which is easy to understand, right? For example, I am a data scientist who is working on, detecting cancer and everything from, health records, right? So detecting whether a person would survive, say for greater than 1 year, given he has a heart cardiac failure. Now I am a data scientist. I have my background in mathematics and computer science. I do not really understand how do you can even predict survival using some basic things like hemoglobin, creatinine and all of this. So for me to understand exactly how you can do that, I have to talk to radiologists, I have to talk to cardiologists, I have to understand how these doctors kind of work with this data, what are the features they come up with, what are the features they look at to figure out whether a person is going to survive or not. So this is something that is not inherently, probably not there in you. Probably you could be someone who's working on healthcare data science for the last 10-15 years, and you are probably someone who's been working on, who is a doctor and who has been working on diagnosis of different diseases for the last 10-15 years, and you switch to data science. You probably already have enough domain expertise, right? But for example, you're someone who's completely new in data science. You have started off from without any much of a background in any particular domain. You definitely don't have an understanding of the problem that you're starting off with, right? When you're starting, say, a problem in finance, a problem in marketing, a problem in healthcare, you really don't have enough domain to start up with. That's the point of time you kind of go to a domain expert, try and understand how they solve the problem. So when you're, say, trying to predict if the market movement in a stock market or something similar to that, right? If you are someone who's coming from a science or a computer maths kind of a background, you probably don't understand as much as of it. So it's a good idea to probably talk to someone who's a domain expert, understand what are the features they use for market predictions. So everyone uses prices, but they use some other indicators, right, for predicting stock market prices. So what are those indicators that people use to come predict, right? So those indicators are nothing but some linear combination of your prices, right? Prices across last 10 minutes, prices across last 15 minutes, and then some combination of all of that. So that's how traders, when they're trading on the stock market, those are the kind of indicators they're looking at while placing their trades. So if you're a data scientist who's just starting out with market data and trying to predict what would be the movement, you cannot directly start off by just fitting a linear regression line through all of your stock prices, right? You have to use something which is a lot more maneuvered, a lot more expertise driven. So that's why you should go and always talk to a domain expert whenever you're starting out in problem. If you're a data scientist and you don't have a domain expertise, please go and talk to people. That's how data science is done. Data science is not done within closed chambers. You go out, explore the world, talk to people, understand how the data looks like, and that's how you do data science. Now the second part of the thing is, which is something which you have already described, is something called combining features. Now combining features sounds intuitive, right? Because as we had talked about the earlier problem, we had a washroom where we had washroom area was supposed to be measured, and we had three features, which was basement bath area, basement half bath. So there are different bath area related features, and there were three different features for them. Ideally, we should be combining all of that into one particular features, right? So that is all about combining features. So you have features F1 and F2. Combining features is nothing but you have original features F1, F2, F3. Sorry, F3 and so on and so forth till Fn. And you combine some of them. Either you combine F1 plus F2 plus F3. You take an average, or you take F1 into F2 by F3. Or F1, F2. Square root by Fn. You know what? You get the idea, right? You get the drift. It can do anything that you may want to do with all of these features, right? You can combine them linearly, non-linearly, whatever you may want to do. but you've somehow combined these features. And this is what, for example, I was giving in the stock market example. That's what a lot of traders use, right? So the instead of using directly raw price as it is, they use some of the volume into price over last 10 minutes, how that is changing from moving average, something which is a lot more informative rather than directly using your features as it is. So for this particular case, let's take the example, right? We talked about the basement bath area and we figured out that there were four features basically, which is basement full bath, basement half bath, full bath and half bath. So there were four features which were relating to bath area and we should ideally not use all four of them, right? That could save us some space and time. And also we remember that in case of linear regression, we wanted our data to be non-collinear, right? We did not want our data, so we should not have our data features which are related to each other, right? In case of this, you can see that basement full bath, basement half bath, and full bath and half bath might be slightly correlated, right? So it might be a good idea to replace all of them with one particular feature and get rid of the collinearity problem altogether, right? So that's what we are going to do right now. We are going to combine all of these four features and let's get rid of the collinearity, right? So what we have done is we have now created a new feature which is called total bath, which is nothing but basement full bath plus half into your half bath plus full bath again half into your half bath, right? So you are basically combining all the washroom area that is there in the house into one particular feature, which is a total bath area. And that is basically nothing but, and this is intuitive, right? So basement full bath area, that would be whatever number that comes out to be, you add that to the half of your basement half bath area, right? Because that's a half bath. So you multiply it by 0.5 so that your basement full bath and basement half bath are comparable. So now you have come up with one new feature, which is nothing but a linear combination of your four features. And clearly this is giving you an advantage because now you have got rid of two things. You have taken care of the collinearity problem, which is a big problem when you're dealing with linear regression. And also you're saving some features, right? You're instead of using four features, now you're just going to use one feature. That saves some computation and time.
Log on to GreyAtom's learning platform to unlock more free content. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates.